So after months of trying to reach out to Tom and Ted Ridenour to get a bass clarinet to try, and being unsuccessful in getting them to respond to me, I wonder why, I went out yesterday and bought myself a 925c Ridenour Lyrique low C bass clarinet with my very own money, because so many of you have asked me what I think of it, and I was curious to try it too. So I bought one, it's sitting right here. I'm going to take it out of the case and give you a full rundown and my opinion of this instrument. Here we go. Okay, so first impressions. The case itself is a little bit smaller, I think, than the RS Berkeley, if memory serves me. And one thing I did notice when I was taking it home was that the instrument, I could hear it jiggling around inside the case. Let's open it up and take a look at what might be the cause of that. So the whole point of a case, and I don't want to spend too much time on this, is to protect the instrument from the elements and also protecting it from jiggling around. You want the bass clarinet to be completely immobilized, totally still. So what I noticed in here when I opened it is the instrument has a lot of room to play, both up and down, side to side, and up, and vertically this way. So what that means is that every step you take with this case, the instrument is moving. What that does is it throws it out of adjustment really quickly. The keys, the pads, the rods, everything is subject to being sort of jiggled around. That just means you're going to spend a little bit more time at the repair person. You might want to think about getting another case when you pick up this instrument. So thing to think about. All right, so about the instrument itself, it comes with a mouthpiece. Ridenour makes his own. It comes with, a swab and strap and cork grease, mouthpiece cap and ligature. So let's put this together. So the Lyrique 925C bass clarinet is a hard rubber instrument. It is not wood, but I think that Ridenour, he makes a distinction between hard rubber and plastic, which some of the other instruments are made out of. I'm not sure what the difference is. I couldn't tell you even if I looked at two of them side by side, but this is a hard rubber bass clarinet. It feels pretty solid. It's got a really nice latching mechanism between the two joints so that when you put it together, it stops where it's supposed to so you don't bend keys. The bell and the neck. The bass clarinet neck has a wider angle than the Buffet. It's more like a Selmer 67. Selmer does make necks that have a little bit more of a tight angle this way, but this one comes into the mouth at, I think, what is the perfect angle. This is a great angled neck. All right, let's give it a listen. Okay, so the first thing I'm going to do now that I have it together is I'm going to play a slow chromatic scale up from low C all the way up to high, high C. And what I'm going to be listening for and feeling for is how evenly the instrument plays. And what do I mean by that? I mean that when I play a note, does the next note feel more or less the same? Or does it require more air for it to produce a sound? Or is it more free-blowing, which is usually what you want. You want something that feels really free-blowing and doesn't push back against you. So I'm going to see how that feels, and then we'll talk about it. Here we go. Okay, so I have to confess that the first thing I did, I played this instrument for about 20 minutes, and I started making a video where I was playing a chromatic scale, and it was playing very unevenly. The notes in my right hand, these lower notes here, were very stuffy, and the notes up on this hand were incredibly free-blowing. Here, give it a quick listen. Played it for a little while, I felt it had to have been a leak. One of the keys was probably not closing, so I took a closer look at it, and it turned out to be, yes, in fact, one of the keys, this one in particular here, was not closing properly when I pushed this key down, which created a leak, which just meant the instrument was playing inefficiently, and when I had to blow, it gave it a lot more resistance because the air was leaking out of that key. Now, most of the inexpensive bass clarinets on the market do not have adjustment screws on this joint right here, especially around these keys. I have to give props to Ridenour for putting them there, because if you don't have them, you have to bend metal. And whenever you bend metal, the metal will often bend right back and you'll be back in the same situation. With an adjustment screw, you screw it and it stays. So once I actually repaired it, it plays really nicely. Let me play that scale again. big sound, especially when I'm blowing hard. So this brings up an important point. If you buy your clarinet or bass clarinet on the internet, which is very easy to do, you do not have the benefit of a repair person in a shop that can fix it for you when you're trying it. So if you were able to buy your instrument at a place where they had a repair person, you would play it and you probably would think, huh, it sounds good, but these notes are hard to play. And you would go to this repair person, hopefully, and you would say, this feels weird, can you take a look at it? And they probably would have found the exact same thing that I found when I started adjusting it. They would be able to adjust it for you. If you buy it on the internet and you have it sent to your house, you don't have a repair person there, probably, and you will have to take your brand new instrument that you spent all of that money on and spend an extra $100 to go to a repair person to have them adjust your brand new instrument. So that's just something to think about. If you have the option of picking up an instrument at a music shop, you will be much, much better off, because then if there is a problem, they will fix it for you rather than you having to figure out what's wrong with it and getting it fixed. Okay, so this is a spectrum analyzer, and how we're going to use it is, when I first played the bass clarinet a second ago, I was playing it, feeling how it played in terms of, did it feel resistant? Did one note to the next feel like it was even playing? But that actually has a correlation to its sound. When a note is more resistant, more often than not, it is more muffled. And you can see that when we use a spectrum analyzer. So what we're going to do is I'm going to play the instrument, and I'm going to go the same chromatic scale, and we're going to see how evenly this thing stays. So let me talk about this thing here. First off, I have to talk a little bit about how sound works. Every instrument and your voice and every sound has a different fingerprint, what we'll call a sound print up here. So when I play an A, when I'm tuning my instrument in orchestra and the flute is playing an A, how can you tell the difference between a clarinet and a flute? Well, it is this sound print, right? And you can tell the clarinet sound print because it has basically the same sound print as every other clarinet. Now, my voice, I'm going to use as an example, I sing an octave below, so instead of A440, it'll be A220. Well, first off, what is A440? What is 440 and what is 220? What that stands for is hertz. And what a hertz is a vibration. One hertz would be one vibration per second. So 440, A440 is 440 vibrations per second. Your reed is actually vibrating 440 times a second when you're playing an A440. If you're playing an A220, it's vibrating at 220 times a second. But that's not the only thing that the reed is doing, because the instrument itself is vibrating the air, and it's vibrating it mainly at 440 beats per second, but it's also got these other partials that we've talked about in the past, which appear higher than that main A. So if I'm going to sing an A, let me see if I can grab one out of thin air. A, so I'm singing basically an A220, except a little flat. You get the main note, which is this spike right here. A, and then this is the fingerprint of my sound, my voice. Now, if I were to close my mouth and muffle the sound, what happens up here? Let's take a look. A, when I have my mouth closed, you'll notice that there's a lot less frequency energy happening up here. A, so that's what we're going to be looking for when we play the bass clarinet. Does each note have a similar sound print? Because if I go, they basically look the same. But if I go, they look totally different and they sound really bizarre. So let's look at it with the bass clarinet. Now, obviously, each note has a different sort of resonance, and so you can see that with the spectrum analyzer, but listening to it and looking at it, it looks basically the way it should. awesome. The next thing we're going to do is see how well in tune the instrument plays with itself. And for that, we're going to use this tuner. Now, I've used this before, but I'll explain it for those of you who might not remember. The way this works is the biggest bars here are coarse tuning. If it's really out of tune, these bars are going to move. And it moves here to finer and finer and finer tuning. So the idea is if I play this note perfectly in tune, all four of these things are going to be totally still. Now I'm going to play an A440, which is our tuning note, as a bass line because that's the note we're going to be using when we tune most of the time in band or orchestra. So as I play the instrument starting from low C going all the way up to high C, if this instrument is in tune with itself, these bars will stay still. The instrument is basically a little bit flat, so if I pushed in, most of those notes would come up into tune. That just means that that B that I tune to tends to be sharp. So something to think about when you're tuning is that if you tune that B so that it's perfectly in tune when you're tuning with your orchestra, you are generally going to be flat to everybody. So you might want to think about tuning that B. You know this about your instrument now. You tune that B a little bit sharp so the rest of the instrument is in tune, and then whenever you play that B, you have to lip it down a little bit. That would be the case with this instrument, but I am impressed, actually, with how well in tune this Ridenour Lyrique is. Really am. Okay, I've done my homework. I've done my chromatic scale to see how it feels and how evenly it feels. We've looked at it through a spectrum analyzer, and we've looked at it through a tuner. Now, I'm just going to play a piece of music. Through the instrument, and it kept its core when I played a little bit more quietly. So that's, you know, that's not a mark of a student instrument. That this instrument has a little bit of depth and it has some nuance to it. So impressed with that. That said, I still had to blow really, really hard to get the sound out, and that just means that I was not able to get all of the leaks out of the instrument. I am certain that there are still pads that are not sealing properly. And that brings up an important point. When you buy an instrument, a new one, or a used one, a student model, or even sometimes a professional model instrument, you're going to want to take it to a repair person immediately to make sure that all of the pads are sealing properly and the instrument is properly in adjustment. Because if you don't do that, you're never going to know whether it's the instrument that's holding you back or whether it's you holding you back. I can tell you for sure that this mouthpiece and reed combination is great because I played it on my other instruments and it sounds super. So I know that it's the instrument that's a problem, but not everybody does. So if you bought the bass clarinet at a shop, there's a repair person there. If you bought it on the internet or you bought it some other way where there wasn't a repair person, do spend a little bit of money, take it to a repair person, and have it sort of looked at top to bottom to make sure it is sealing properly. And then the second thing you do is get rid of that case, because the case that this thing comes with, I'm sorry to say, is not good for the instrument. It will go straight out of adjustment. If you spend a few hundred dollars, and they can be expensive, on a good case, you will save that money many times over the life of the instrument by not having to pay a repair person to adjust it all of the time. So that's something to think about. You gotta make that investment in a good case to protect the instrument. So, Tom, Ted Ridenour, your Lyrique bass clarinet, the 925C, I am impressed with. I did not know what to expect, but I have to give it a thumbs up. It is a good instrument for those people who cannot afford or don't want to buy a high-end $10,000, $12,000 professional bass clarinet. For a sub-$3,000 bass clarinet, I have not played anything better than this yet. If you're looking for a bass clarinet, I do recommend it. You can buy these in a lot of places. I picked this one up, and frankly, I'm going to take it back to the shop that you see on the screen. That's where I bought it from. You can buy this very instrument from them starting on Monday, because I'm taking it back. Okay? Thanks for watching, and I hope this was helpful for those of you who are looking for a review of the Ridenour. There you go. Take care.